For 8 years, President Barack Hussein Obama felt like he were some kind of god that ruled our great nation. He thought wrong. After 8 years of hell, the Supreme Court has finally decided to prove to everyone once and for all that Obama completely violated the United States Constitution. The Supreme Court, earlier this month, ruled that Obama appointee Leif Solomon illegally served as the acting general counsel for the National Labor Relations Board. Solomon spent 3 years in this position. While Barack Obama ignored the U.S. Senate's reasons on why they would not take up Solomon's nomination, he made damn sure that Solomon kept his job. The Federal Vacancies Reform Act of 1998 clearly states Solomon was supposed to step down from any company he had stock in, or sat on a board. When Solomon refused to do this, the U.S. Senate refused to take up his nomination. During Solomon's illegal appointment, he intervened in a case on behalf of a company he has stock in. This is the kind of lawlessness we had in the previous administration. The media gave Obama, as well as the rest of the administration, a pass. Let a Republican U.S. Senator make a wrong foot gesture in the men's restroom, and it's blasted all over the world, and pushed hard until the senator either resigns, or is forced out. Eric Holder literally got away with MR during Fast and Furious, and yet the media just let it go as if it were something that happens every day, and no one really cared. President Trump knows firsthand what it's like to be attacked by the media. It's a good thing our POTUS knows how to handle them, and put them in their place from time to time. In a 6-2 opinion, written authored by Chief Justice John Roberts, the court ruled that Barack Hussein Obama violated the Constitution. Surprise, surprise, surprise. Unlike every other president in modern history, Barack Hussein Obama is not stepping aside for the good of the country to let the new president govern. Out of office for under a year, Barack Hussein Obama already has a community organizing organization with 250 offices around the country and 30,000 employees in place. Their sole purpose is to interfere and fight the Trump administration every step of the way. It is despicable. It is un-American. The name of his new leftist nonprofit group is called OFA. Get used to that, folks. It will soon be as famous as George Soros and Black Lives Matter. OFA stands for Organizing for Action. How appropriate. The community organizer is going back to organizing, albeit on a much larger scale, not to mention more violent and destructive. It's obvious that Soros money is at the forefront of it all. It's all so obvious, but the left continues to deny, deny, deny. Barack and Michelle Obama deliberately moved into an 8,000-square-foot mansion just 2 miles from President Donald Trump's current home, the White House. Obama will also be leasing office space in the headquarters building of the National Wildlife Building. It's all too suspicious. The Daily Mail has also reported that Obama's closest advisor, Valerie Jarrett, has also moved into the mansion. The reasoning? She is working beside Michelle Obama and Barack Obama. She is extremely close with the Obamas. She also lived in the White House with them while Obama was in office. Jared was involved in many major domestic and foreign policy decisions while Obama was in office as well. Many Americans are concerned that Barack Obama is working on constructing a shadow government to disrupt the presidency of Donald Trump. It seems that we are getting awfully close to sedition. Obama is walking a fine line, and many are claiming that he is working against the best interests of the United States government. The New York Post reported, he's working behind the scenes to set up what will effectively be a shadow government, to not only protect his threatened legacy, but to sabotage the incoming administration and its popular America First agenda. Barack Obama didn't care at all about the Constitution. Take the Chrysler bailout, for example. Yes, the Bush admin started it, but Barack Obama's admin used the TARP funds to bully Chrysler's secured creditors who were entitled to absolute priority into accepting 30 cents on every dollar while the smaller creditors received much more. Obamacare, political profiling by the IRS, recess appointments, DACA and DAPA, assault on free speech and due process on college campuses, the Clean Power Act, the WATIS rule, net neutrality, EPA's cap and trade, just to name a few. The audacity that Barack Obama had to shreds the Constitution is despicable. That's only the beginning. It was obviously difficult to narrow that enumeration to just 10, and I cheated by putting all the Obamacare shenanigans under one item. Some may complain that I should have prioritized other kinds of executive actions, whether regarding GS or transgender bathroom access or electricity regulation. Others may prefer to invoke President Obama's decision not to subject the Iran nuclear treaty to a Senate vote, aided by Foreign Relations Committee Chairman Bob Corker's naive complicity, or engaging in the Boebert doll prisoner swap without notifying Congress. Sadly, the possibilities for this parlor game are nearly endless. Then, of course, there's the administration's abysmal performance before the Supreme Court, where its win percentage hovers around 45%, as against a historical norm of 60-70%. The Justice Department has even suffered nearly 50 unanimous losses, half again as many as under George W. Bush or Bill Clinton. These cases have come in such disparate areas as criminal procedure, religious liberty, property rights, immigration, securities regulation, tax law, and the separation of powers. They have nothing in common other than incredible assertions of federal power. The government's arguments across this wide variety of cases would essentially allow the executive branch to do whatever it wants without constitutional restraint. Are these really the kind of powers President Obama and his progressive enablers would want their worst enemies to have? As my colleague Gene Healy writes in the latest issue of Reason, the very idea of President Trump seemed like a thought experiment a libertarian might have invented to get a liberal friend to focus on the dangers of concentrated power. Now it's an experiment we're going to run in real life, starting January 20th, 2017. If you live by executive action, you'd asterisk E by executive action, whether that means reversing President Obama's policies or pocketing his constitutional excesses for future use. Federalist.